Long, long ago, when American automobiles ruled the roads, when the U.S. led the world in technology, let the Japanese have transistors, we'll use our great vacuum tubes. Two brothers emerged from the heartland of this great nation. These two brothers were in many respects complete opposites. Alan Roberts is a powerfully built man with age beyond his years showing on his ruggedly handsome face. As a top research scientist, Alan travels around the world to conduct work for Alistair Research. Confident and with undying curiosity for the unknown, Alan has pursued his career with zeal. Jason is 10 years younger and regards Alan as more of a father figure than a brother. After Jason graduated from California State College, Alan arranged a job for Jason at Alistair Research. Still somewhat naive about the world, Jason has an athletic build and is considered by some to be the all-American boy. For several months, Alan has been in the Amazon River Basin. Very soon, events will occur that will change the lives of these two brothers, irrevocably and forever. Jason Roberts arrives at work unaware that events several thousand miles away have drawn him into an amazing adventure.
Very funny, Jason. Why don't you go back to the lab and play with those horrid little rats of yours? Ew! I've always hated rats! Now leave me alone!
Jason's laboratory is small and cluttered with various pieces of scientific equipment. Different types of chemicals are haphazardly scattered on the cabinet tops. A chemical emergency shower stands above the Bunsen burner, and a brown rat scurries about in a mesh wire cage.
You wanted to visit Mr. Thornick's office.
To the president's office was a horrible, gut-wrenching experience for the working class. A cold, humorless authoritarian. Wilbur Thornick has all the warmth of a dead fish. Immediately upon entering and sitting down, there's a sense that something is terribly wrong. Thornick's eyes, usually dark and somber, attempt a pleasant gait. His thin, taut mouth forces out a pathetic smile. It is a pitiful effort to soften the sledgehammer blow he's about to deliver.
I'm afraid I have bad news for you, Jason. Your brother's expedition to the Amazon has been attacked, and he's missing. We're doing everything we can to get more information. I'm sorry.
As Jason turns to walk out of the room, Wilbur Thornick says, I want you to go home for a while and rest. Take the whole day if you feel it's absolutely necessary. But his magnanimous gesture falls on deaf ears. Stunned and hurt, Jason staggers from Thornick's office to the parking lot. It takes all his inner strength to avoid turning into a pathetic, blubbering idiot. As Jason drives to his home, questions roll around in his head. Alan's work was always dangerous, but wasn't he indestructible? Is he really gone? Jason's apartment is tastefully decorated in contemporary 1950s style and fashion. A virtually priceless original painting on velvet hangs proudly above the white marble mantel. The mahogany bookcase contains various keepsakes and a complete set of encyclopedias. But the pride and joy of his life is a 20-inch black and white Dumont television set. Yes, Jason's pad is about as hip as any cool cat could imagine. Jason has received shocking news that his brother Alan's expedition has been viciously attacked in the Amazon jungle. Stunned and upset, Jason arrives home to find a package from Alan has arrived in the mail.
Jason, what I'm about to divulge must be shared with no one. As I'm sure you are aware, our expedition was savagely attacked by someone or something. All of the details will be shared with you when we meet. For now, I'll tell you that the expedition was on the verge of a great discovery, which ruthless men will stop at nothing to get their hands on. But there's more. The attack that night sent a chill through my very soul. I've never been superstitious, but I believe supernatural powers are pursuing me, and it makes my flesh crawl. To continue my work, you must get the contents of my storage drawer inside the mountain vault. Read the information on the microfilm and bring everything to me. Since no one must know about me for now, you'll have to find a resourceful way to get into the vault. I've also sent a key to my cabinet. Use it to get the combination to my safe. In case the letter falls into the wrong hands, I've written the instructions to find me in code. Use the little Orphan Annie decoder ring we used as children. Jason, I'm being pursued by forces who will stop at nothing to get the information I have. Be cautious, but act quickly, or it may be too late. Alan.
About Alan. That's terrible news. I told you before. I can't do that. I'd turn up missing like your brother. You told me that already, and I need to get back to work. Very funny, Jason. Why don't you go back to the lab and play with those horrid little rats of yours? Ew! I've always hated rats! Now leave me alone!
Alan's lab is like Alan. Neat and well organized. On the far wall, there are curios and collectibles gathered during his extensive world travels. A well-used projection screen hangs overhead, and the large picture windows offer an incredible view.
Thank you.
security vault is hewn into the rough granite face of 12,000-foot Mount Hiawatha. This is the era of paranoia. Enemies of democracy are constantly after the secrets of U.S. technology. Alistair Research does not take its security lightly. Any violation of procedure is grounds for termination. And they really mean termination. In the name of the law, this is a restricted area. Leave immediately or I will be forced to arrest you.
Must be terminated.
Don't miss our next exciting chapter, Heavy Metal Monster. Jason has entered the top secret security vault in search of Alan's files. Little does he realize this area is being patrolled by Bob. Binary Overseer Biped. This robotic terror is in development for use against the vast communist hordes who plan the overthrow of the American way of life. Until that day, this metal titan guards the secrets that keep this country strong.
Thank you. For you. I may look young, but these aches and pains make me feel ancient, and I'm getting so forgetful. Yesterday I forgot my purse, and last week I left the lights on in my car and had to leave the station to turn them off. I'd lose my ears if they weren't attached. That sounds so nice. But I can't leave my station during working hours unless summoned by a supervisor or security.
Thank you. again? Darn it! I'll be right back!
Jason arrives to find that the interior decorator from hell has paid a visit. The apartment is totally trashed. Someone has even slashed the velvet painting. This could take years of careful restoration. Someone was looking for something in a real hurry. The landlord is not going to be happy about this. Thank you. Thousands of miles away, in a dirty, forgotten village at the edge of the jungle, a tall, fat policeman known as Colonel Sanchez sits behind a desk. Though not officially a colonel, Sanchez uses the title as a sign of his own importance. Even the term policeman is a paradox. There is no law here. The police are no more than legalized criminals who exploit the poor people of this region. Sanchez knows about Jason and Alan. His agents did not get what they needed from Jason's apartment, but soon, Jason would be in Sanchez's country. It will be much easier then. For now, Sanchez impatiently waits for information on Alan's whereabouts.
Come in!
Huh.
The attempt to recover the package has failed. What have you found at the campsite?
We have nothing. The men will not go near that place, but we know the brother survived. We will continue the search.
He must be found!
Don't miss our next exciting chapter, Hot Pursuit. Jason prepares to leave for Rio Blanco, unaware that somewhere in South America, Colonel Sanchez and his men are laying plans to recover the documents Alan has requested. Even now, a trap is being put in place for Jason. The country's military headquarters. But that was 17 revolutions ago. Now it's so old and dilapidated it makes some ancient Incan cities look new. Old U.S. military Quonset huts serve as hangars, and the wooden tower could have used paint 30 years ago. A crumbling, stucco-over-brick two-story building serves as the terminal.
Buenos dias, senor. How may I help you this beautiful day? Rio Blanco? Senor, I'm afraid nobody in his right mind goes to Rio Blanco. There are no scheduled flights. Go to the Green Monkey. Give the bartender with a long scar this card. He will know what to do.
Mr. Rio Blanco.
Yeah? I got cargo for Rio Blanco.
The pilot, in a Hawaiian shirt and cheap sunglasses, looks like the type of guy who's always landing at makeshift runways in the middle of the night. He introduces himself as Tony Martin, an ex-Cadillac salesman from Houston. He tells Jason that since he already has cargo for Rio Blanco, he will only charge $150 for the trip. With some reservation, Jason hops in the back of the cargo plane. After a bumpy takeoff, the plane is airborne. Jason finds a comfortable place to lie down and takes a nap. When he awakes, it is several hours later. Suddenly, the cockpit door flies open and Martin takes a step into the cargo hold and raises a .45 automatic pistol. It is at this point Jason realizes he can kiss the free soft drinks and peanuts goodbye.
Step through the door, partner. You're gonna dive like a condor to a corpse.
Jason is being threatened by Martin, a pilot hired by Sanchez to recover documents and get rid of Jason.
Step through the door, partner. You're gonna dive like a condor to a corpse. It's not so far. You might land in a lake. You'll have to outswim the piranhas. I'm waiting.
As the screams of Martin fade into the distance, Jason knows he's not out of the woods yet. The plane is losing altitude and heading for the jungle floor. small raft handles remarkably well in the lake, which is still churning from the airplane's impact. Jason inches to the shore painfully. His neck feels like it has been stretched by the hangman, and he could use a good chiropractor. Rising above the jungle wall, far in the distance, he sees a church cross through the mist. With the promise of comfort from this green hell, Jason begins his walk. Fortunately for Jason, the plane crash occurs near his destination of Rio Blanco. If you look up the word dirty in the dictionary, there could be a picture of Rio Blanco. On the plaza, there's a water well made of adobe bricks. A crumbling cantina stands beside an ancient flea bag hotel that once housed the traveling rubber barons. Even the Catholic mission has long since been deserted.
Get away from here!
Upon arriving in Rio Blanco, Jason runs into El Loco, the gigantic town bully who owns the local hotel.
Yes, senor? I'm very busy right now. I must prepare this meal for El Loco. He is the giant crazy man who owns the hotel. He's out of his mind, and the villagers are terrified of him. There is only one telephone in the village, and it is in the hotel, but you will never get to use it. It doesn't matter. No one is allowed inside the hotel to use the telephone. You could be hurt very badly if you tried. El Loco has always been a bully. Being a giant affects some people like that sometimes. But he received a kick in the cabeza by a donkey 6 months ago and began to have visions. He threw everyone out of the hotel and claimed it as a holy place. Everyone is forbidden to enter. He says that he awaits a message from God, so the line must not be busy when he calls. He is loco, senor. Of course, but I must finish this meal. I will prepare several servings for him. A man as huge as a house has a very large appetite. I'm sorry, I can say no more.
pleasure to see an American. Join me for a drink. We will go in time, but be patient. I must be sure you are Jason and not an imposter. Papers can be forged. In Rio, you can buy passports on any street corner. I need to ask you questions that only Alan's brother would know. First, what year did your brother win the stock car trophy? Oh, very good. How many brothers and sisters do you have? Very good. You're coming along nicely. What's your brother's favorite movie? Okay, Jason, I believe you. I'll take you to Alan.
Maya leads Jason from the canoe to an obscure ramshackle hut hidden in the trees. The glow of a lantern flickers ahead. Maya and Jason step inside. Seated near a rough-hewn table is Alan. Jason is stunned at the sight. Alan looks 20 years older than just a few months ago. On top of that, his face is swollen and bruised as if he has been beaten, and his arm is in a sling. Any movement causes him great pain.
My name is Maya. I found Alan sick and injured. I helped him get back here, and then he contacted you.
Jason, you're not going to believe what I'm about to tell you.
As you know, Alistair Research was contacted by Brazilian authorities to investigate reports of amazing forest regeneration in slashed and burned areas of the remote Amazon basin. From the first day upon our arrival at the edge of civilization, we were hampered by a certain Colonel Sanchez. There had been reports of savage attacks by demonic forces in the basin, and Sanchez insisted upon sending some of his men along for protection. But their real purpose was espionage. We visited several of the reforested spots and investigated every possibility for regrowth, but the only item out of the ordinary was a very slight trace of radiation. Our luck changed when we came upon an outpost, savagely attacked by so-called specters and demons. When we reached the site, it was already overgrown, but a small pool of liquid caused our Geiger counter to go wild. Tests showed the liquid definitely increased the speed of regrowth of vegetation. A guide told us of an unexplored region known in legend as Sitio Maldito, the accursed place. Supposedly, in this spot flowed enchanted waters that held the secret of life. They're protected by condemned spirits of foolish and greedy men who died trying to discover the wisdom of the gods. Intrigued by the legend, we decided to explore this region. We marched for days through nearly impenetrable jungle growth.
Each night, the men huddled near the fire, and many reported seeing eerie figures that seemed to be watching from a distance, tracking our movements. Every morning, there were new desertions of frightened men. When Sanchez's men deserted, they stole much of our research information. On the 10th night, it was extremely hot, and the men were edgy and restless. I tried to sleep in my tent, but wasn't having much luck. Suddenly, we heard a horrible screeching sound. It was as if Satan had loosed all the condemned of hell back upon the earth. Then from everywhere came a shower of arrows. I saw the men fall like rag dolls. Carlos fell through the tent with an arrow that had pierced his heart. I struggled to gain my bearings and slid through the back of my tent. A poisoned arrow tore through my shoulder, and I crawled as best I could to the edge of the river and jumped in. I must have floated for several days down the river. When I finally regained my senses, I was burning with a fever from the poison. Although I have yet to shake the effects, it was Maya who saved me. Jason, we're on the verge of the most important scientific discovery of our age, and I'm determined to make it. Colonel Sanchez is now aware of our work, and he will stop at nothing to get it for his purposes. But a discovery of this nature must be protected from men like him. Maya was doing government research when she found me, and now she's willing to help. But we must start now, or it'll be too late.
After a few days, Alan is feeling strong enough to begin the journey. The three travelers move slowly along a narrow footpath that winds slowly upward through thick jungle vegetation. The ground is rough and broken by gullies and undergrowth. Though no one has been seen, there is a sense they are not alone. Alan leads the others along a trail that parallels a river. The sky gets darker and more ominous as a storm gradually overtakes them from the west. A hot, agitating wind rustles through the foliage. Finally, they reach a decrepit bridge at the edge of a wide gorge. The cliffs tower above the rushing water far below. A feeling of exhaustion overcomes them as they stare across the gap to the other side. Suddenly, the sound of gunfire cracks through the jungle. Alan turns and looks quickly down the path to the approaching men in army fatigues.
I'll hold them off.
Don't miss our next exciting chapter, The Bridge of Death. Jason, Alan, and Maya are being pursued by a platoon of Colonel Sanchez's death squad. They find themselves at the edge of a wide gorge. Their only means of escape appears to be an ancient rope bridge in serious disrepair. Jason stares into the gorge as Maya grabs at his shoulder. Jason, we've got to take cover. They stumble and run through the brush until they can no longer hear the gunfire from the soldiers. Alan had made sure no soldier would find them for a while. What now? Perhaps Jason should just give up and go home. Then Jason resolves that Alan's sacrifice will not be in vain. Jason pulls out a piece of map he recovered from the vault. The name Hans Stroheim has been noted next to the village of Teve.
For you, senor. What business do you have upriver? I need to know what I'm getting into. Sounds like a worthy cause. Okay, what else? Okay, let's go.
In a desperate attempt to reach the village of Tefe, Jason and Maya have taken passage on the ancient tramp steamer known as the Amazon Queen. The captain and his unsavory first mate quietly whisper and scheme in the captain's cabin.
Thank you. senor, this is where you get off.
Jason!
Don't miss our next exciting chapter, Slave Traders. Jason and Maya inadvertently find themselves traveling upriver with slave traders. Jason has been knocked off the boat, and Maya is being held captive to be sold. Jason follows the ship from shore until the captain stops for the night. Jason must devise a rescue plan for Maya. the captain groggily wakes from a restless sleep and notices the keys are missing from the table. As he stumbles from his cabin, he sees the lifeless body of his first mate slowly drifting downriver. The answer is clear. Jason has come back for Maya. He pulls the hammer back on his pistol and quietly approaches the first mate's cabin.
Jason! Hurry, Jason! Jason!
I need your help.
I knew all men were pigs.
Just like a woman, thought Jason. You risk your life to save them from slave traders, and yet they're never happy. Go figure. But concern over Maya's remark about men being pigs would have to wait. Deep in the jungle, with no sign of civilization in any direction, they are lost. Worse, they have no supplies, and no hope of finding any quickly. For 2 days, they march aimlessly through the thick undergrowth. Jason grows more anxious each day, but Maya seems strangely unconcerned. In the afternoon of the third day, a fire could be seen flickering ahead. As they approach, the outline of several thatched huts becomes apparent. The small tribe appears to be totally primitive. Had they seen men from the outside before? Were they cannibals? Was it safe to make contact? As a result of their efforts in healing the young Indian boy, Jason and Maya are given supplies in a canoe. One of the villagers gives them advice on traveling the river. At the first branch, go left. At the next two branches, go right. At the following branch, go left. Avoid the sharp rocks in the river. The two travelers are now equipped to continue their journey in search of Hans Stroheim.
Have you ever canoed before?
Secrets. Jason and Maya canoe downriver to locate noted archaeologist Hans Stroheim. Alan had needed something from him in order to pinpoint a location of the source of regenerative liquid.
Oh.
Jason checks the map and realizes they must be very close to Stroheim. Then, up ahead in a small clearing, they see several huts. Jason guides the canoe to the riverbank, and they follow a well-worn path to the largest hut near the middle of the settlement. Inside is a ghost of a man who sits in a wheelchair. The man is none other than Hans Stroheim.
Who are you? What do you want?
That is very unfortunate for both of us. I was only interested in talking to Alan. I have nothing to say to you. Good day. That is fine, but it is only part of what I need. Several years ago, your brother came into possession of an ancient Spanish compass that had engraved upon it the location that tied to a map crucial to my work. It was the property of Diaz Velasquez. Velasquez had stolen the emeralds known as the Eyes of the Jaguar from Cortez, and he escaped to this area of the Amazon. Alan contacted me several months ago and said he would exchange it for information I have on Sitio Maldito. I know much concerning the subject, but I need help finding the emeralds first. Go to this spot and search the region for the great fortress in the trees. If you find evidence of the emerald, I will help you. I can trust no one else to do this, because I know something that no one else could tell you.
Hans Stroheim had shown Jason and Maya the approximate area of the last known location of the conquistadors. It takes several days to hack through the thick vegetation and strangler vines. Each day they move closer to Sitio Maldito, and always there's the feeling of being watched from a distance. As Maya steps inside the ancient structure, her eyes slowly adjust to the dim light inside. Strange, eerie figures begin to appear in outline form. As she looks to the floor, she feels the hair lift from her scalp and her blood turn to ice in her veins. Superstitious terrors fill her mind and her body shudders in horror. Jason and Maya struggle back to the hut of Hans Stroheim. With the emerald in proof of the last resting place of Diaz Velasquez, Stroheim would certainly be willing to give them the information they need to continue on.
At last, one of the great gems I have searched for all these years, and the last entry of Captain Velasquez. This is the realization of my dreams. For this, I shall tell you what your brother wished to know. Ever since the Spanish came to this continent, there has been a strange legend of a brutal tribe of warriors that live in the great thick jungles of the basin. This tribe is said to be like no other, for the warriors are tall, golden-haired women. From the mysterious and inexplicable events I have seen and heard throughout Sitio Maldito, I believe the tribe does exist. You will never live to prove it, where they will kill anyone who trespasses. However, that is your choice. To journey there, get back in your canoe. Follow the river. When you come to the first fork, take the right branch. At the next two forks, take the left branch. At the fourth fork, take the right branch. That will take you to the site where your brother's party was massacred. From there, get back on the river, take the right branches three times, then take one left branch and one right branch. At the end of the last branch, your search will begin.
Jason pulls the canoe to the side of the river. The location is where Stroheim had indicated Alan's campsite had been. Signs of new plant life abound. After a few minute walk, the two travelers come upon a very grisly spectacle. Sanchez fumes. He knows a treasure of infinite value is slipping through his fingers. The soldiers missed a golden opportunity at the bridge. Since then, his scouts have had no sign of Jason or Maya. If they were not spotted soon, his hopes for vast riches would disappear. Lost in thought, he is startled by Corporal Rodriguez standing at attention by his desk.
Jason and Maya have been spotted near the massacre site.
Now we have them.
Jason and Maya continue to canoe downriver to Alan's last campsite. Thank you.
Thank you.
Maya emerges from the crystal blue water and smiles mischievously at Jason. I suppose I should have warned you about the last branch in the river, but I thought you might like the surprise. The water is brisk, but it refreshes the senses and soothes the aching muscles from the long canoe trip. As the sun slowly disappears on the horizon, Jason lights the campfire. The heat is relaxing and sensual in the cool night air.
Jason, for some time you have had suspicions about me, but now I will tell you the truth about myself. I am a scout for the tribe you are seeking. Our tribe has been given the responsibility of protecting this land we call our Emerald Cathedral. Through the ages, our experiences with men have proven them to be ruthless and wicked, concerned only with material gain and selfish pleasure. We have witnessed their inhumane treatment of the natives in this region, and so we deal harshly with all those who would trespass here. Because of this, I am in part responsible for the death of your brother, for I alerted the tribe to the presence of the expedition. When I found your brother, however, I felt a strange compassion for him, and began to wonder if I had been mistaken, believing all men to be heartless and cruel. Now that I have learned more about you and Alan, I believe that there are good and decent men in this world. Tomorrow, because of my faith in you, I will take you to a city which has always been forbidden to outsiders. I will plead with my sisters to accept you and the help you could offer us. If my sisters do not accept you, it will mean your death, but I believe I can convince them. Our tribe alone may not withstand the invasion of outsiders, and honorable men like yourself may be valuable allies to our cause. An ancient gift from the gods has allowed us to keep the forest safe and protected for many years, but should this gift fall into the hands of unscrupulous, greedy men, both our worlds would be in great peril.
From all around, the sky got darker. The wind brushed against the trees, and the roar of falling water began to fade as Jason and Maya drifted to sleep. The night was perfect, and trouble was a million miles away. But it would come closer very soon.
Maya!
Don't miss our next exciting chapter of Secret Passage. Maya and Jason are preparing to journey to the Forbidden City when they are attacked by Colonel Sanchez. From the hill, the soldiers fire down on them. A bullet strikes Maya, and she disappears into the water. Jason dives into the stream in a frantic attempt to find her. He emerges behind the waterfall with Sanchez and his men close behind. Upon entering the passageway, it opens into a large cavern, but ahead is a narrow corridor. For a moment, Jason gazes upon a gorgeous spectacle and realizes he is on a suspension bridge of highly polished marble, which crosses a gorge that looks bottomless. Directly across the bridge is an opening into a green valley, and all around the cave are strangely shaped stalactites. Erosion has wrought strange limestone figures that appear to be the work of some insane sculptor. As Jason walks further, two magnificent works of carved stone loom in front of him. Suddenly, the stone figures reach into their quivers, and load their bows. Knowing Jason disappeared behind the falls, the police realize there is a passage. The granite wall is strong, but it won't hold forever. Jason runs out of the cavern until his lungs burn. As he stops to catch his breath, tall, blonde women approach from all directions. Anger burns in their eyes. It's obvious they believe he is an enemy invader. They show no interest in his explanation.
Take him to the pit of death!
Jason is thrown into a large, dark pit. As he gains his senses, he feels danger near. He turns to see a gigantic insect behind a colossal wooden gate. Being devoured by one of the most efficient machines in nature would be a novel experience, but one he'd like to put off for a while.
Thank you.
guardians. Jason thrust the spear one more time into the great creature's underbelly, and it shudders and falls to the ground. After a few minutes, two powerfully built Amazon warriors enter the pit and order him to follow. Jason is taken to the entrance of a great temple and told to wait.
Jason.
Be. I saw the bullet strike you at the waterfall. The blood was everywhere, but there's no sign you've been hurt.
Ages ago, the great gods gave us the sacred waters that flow inside the temple. With this gift, we were given the responsibility of protecting the forest from which womankind had first come forth upon the earth. The waters have the power to quickly regenerate the forest growth. When man desecrates our Emerald Cathedral, it is our charge to destroy their settlements and return the rainforest to its original condition. But the water has another power. I survived my injuries because the sacred waters were administered to me before I expired. The waters have the power to heal and to prolong life indefinitely. There is a price, however. Those who receive the water's divine gift of healing must serve in the temple as a priestess. I will never again be able to journey outside the city walls. For hundreds of years, as a scout for my sisters, I have witnessed the barbaric cruelty of evil men who have tortured, murdered, and raped the innocent natives of this land. They have slaughtered human beings in the name of lust, greed, fame, and power. I told you that I believed there were a few decent men in this world. After all that has happened, I'm not so sure. Once you saved me from slave traders so that I would help you. Now you have saved my tribe, but for what purpose? If you seek your fortune... These great emeralds will make you a man of immeasurable wealth in the outside world. The eyes of the jaguar emeralds will be yours upon your promise that you will reveal nothing about our people and our mission. If you saved us because of your feeling for me and our cause, you have but to ask and I am yours. Now you must choose which is most precious.
When I received Alan's message, my only desire was to help him. After he died, I wanted to make sure that his death was not in vain. That's been achieved, if for no other reason than Sanchez was stopped before discovering your secret. But now, the only desire I will ever have for the rest of my life is to be with you, now and forever.
We'll be right back.